learned how to start worrying and hate my brain. I have a great-great-uncle who's 103 years old, and he has over 100 living descendants. Despite this, he still manages to remember every single person's birthday, and his trademark $15 birthday check never goes missing. Spelling geniuses can memorize the spellings of the most arcane words, math whizzes really know pi to 100 digits, Uncle Rudy never forgets his checks, and some crazy bastards really know the dictionary front to back. Our brains are incredible things, but our memories can be cruel. We might remember that time we spilled ketchup all over our shirt, called a stranger mom, sent that Snapchat to the wrong person, or spoke a little bit too loud in a public place. And in most of us, our brain's incredible power is not used to perform some spectacular feat of memory or calculation, but to endlessly replay our most embarrassing moments on repeat whenever we feel most vulnerable. In the shower, bam, awkward memory. On the street, zap, see an old friend, boom. With that in mind, I invite you to close your eyes and transport yourself back in time to 2011, a simpler time. Osama bin Laden recently being killed, the Packers had won the Super Bowl, the King's Speech took home the Oscar for Best Picture, Steve Jobs died, and regrettably, the electropop Party Rock Anthem by LMFAO was shooting up the American charts. Now, I don't know if you remember Party Rock Anthem, as I'm sure it's something we've all tried hard to push out of our minds, but I'll do you a favor by reminding you of how bad it was. It was by the group LMFAO, which was comprised of two overly tan, frat boyish white dudes with horrific afros. Among their hits were the academic classics, Sexy and I Know It, Sorry for Party Rocking, and Champagne Showers. Their album, Sorry for Party Rocking, obtained massive critical hate, even obtaining a rare 0 out of 10 stars by NME Magazine. Despite how terrible they really were, 11-year-old me was totally digging it. There's a picture which my friend Fiona resurfaced the other day, which featured my two friends Owen and Ted, complete with Angry Birds baseball caps and big sunglasses, wearing Party Rock Crew and Every Day I'm Shufflin' t-shirts, which they had excitedly bought at the local Hot Topic. I, on the other hand, was wearing a terrible Jack from Titanic costume, complete with ill-fitting cardigan and fake suspenders, as, of course, it was our first middle school dance. Despite my lack of an LMFAO certified outfit, I can assure you that my LMFAO cred was legit. Owen, Ted, and I were so into LMFAO that we would practice their signature dance move, the shuffle, in formation, wherever we were. Ted's kitchen, my bedroom, Owen's driveway, and of course, the middle school dance floor. We put in serious hours watching the group's music videos to make sure we had gotten its jerky, broken motion correct in order to look like the group's trademark shuffle bar. Now, if you've ever been to a big city, I'm sure you've seen those urban dance troupes. Usually there's a big circle around a boombox and some huge guys with dreadful locks doing flips over petrified Chinese tourists. My family was visiting Boston, near our old neighborhood, when we saw a group of dancers congregated around Faneuil Hall. After finishing an impressive routine that involved a corkscrew backflip and one of those head spin things, they announced that they were looking for volunteers to dance with them. Emboldened by my newly minted dance skills, I flipped my Red Sox cap backwards and rolled up the sleeves of my new MIT shirt. My body and mind separated as I watched myself from inside, paralyzed by the enchanting groove. From my disembodied brain floating above the mall, I saw a chubby, 5-foot-tall, 4-eyed, pasty white kid struck onto the makeshift dance floor, looked the dancers straight in the eye, and began to shuffle in front of hundreds of people. Now, the shuffle was not really a hard dance, but involved some classic elements of the walking man, arms striding forward, sleeve fighting back, and I went for it, embracing the most primal of all behaviors, uncontrolled dance. And I felt my consciousness raise to the heavens. But before I reached gyrating nirvana, I heard two words echo from the main dancer, seemingly disembodied, floating across the square, kissing the statue of Sam Adams as it passed. White chocolate. The words woke me from my dreamlike state as I had two realizations. That white males had finally been released from dance purgatory where we had been kept for all of history, and that I was forever doomed to be the laughingstock of my family for eons. Urban Dictionary defines the term white chocolate as a Caucasian that embraces and is assimilated into black culture. And maybe I was, but that day, I was also inducted into the Knight Family Hall of Shame as a lifetime member. Thank you.